You're probably viewing this video on something like this or this, and it likely has a clock speed measured somewhere in the gigahertz range, or billions of times per second. And this is my computer, and it has a clock speed measured much slower than that, somewhere in the hertz range, or just once per second, making its measured clock speed more than a billion times slower than the device you're using. But what does that even mean? And what exactly is a clock in the world of electronics? Forget answering them traditionally. Instead, we're going to explore the world of clocks by learning what they are and then using what we learn to modify a computer in some crazy ways. Stay tuned. Hello world, Greg Strike here, and welcome back to The Curious Place. I'm glad you're here. In the spotlight today is our home-built computer that we've been modifying throughout the series. In today's episode, we're diving into the world of clocks and how they fit into the realm of electronics. So, clocks, what are they? Well, clocks are essential components in circuits that are responsible for keeping the individual components in a circuit synchronized and moving along. Circuits consist of many different components that all do their own thing, but when put together, form some useful function. If each component does what they're supposed to do, when they're supposed to do it, something useful happens. And you can think of a circuit much like an orchestra, and the clock of the orchestra is a conductor expertly guiding each musician in perfect harmony. In this analogy, the conductor wields their baton to communicate with each orchestra member, who all have their designated roles and sheet music in front of them. The conductor's rhythmic movements set the tempo, dictating the pace at which the musicians play. If the conductor stops conducting, the musicians too would follow his lead and stop playing. It's crucial that every player remains synchronized and attuned to the conductor's cues. If each musician stays in sync, follows the conductor, and plays their parts flawlessly, the result may just be a beautiful song capable of moving even the hardest of hearts. But fundamentally, what actually is a clock? Well, there's definitely not a tiny human in there swinging a baton back and forth, but what is in there is a signal that bounces like a baton back and forth between voltage levels. Let me show you what I mean. Here we see a pretty standard clock signal, and we can see it alternating, also known as oscillating, between voltage levels, high and low. In most cases, the components connected to it are configured to do their tasks on the transitions. That is, when the voltage level changes from a high to a low, or from a low to a high. Also notice the consistency of the timing the transition occurs in this example. The speed at which the voltage level changes determines the frequency, and we can determine the frequency of this signal by counting how many times the signal goes high to low and then back up to high in 1 second. In the case of the device you're watching this on, it's likely doing this over a billion times a second, which is really fast. And the signal we see here is only oscillating about once per second. To understand what's happening in our computers, let's connect this signal up to a pretend processor. That would look a little something like this. On the left, we see instructions written by a programmer, and these are similar to the type of instructions your computer is running right now. The processor is doing things like storing data, reading data from things like a game controller, comparing data, and making decisions on what to do based on the outcome. Note that as the clock oscillates, that the processor simply continues step by step, completing all the tasks the programmer asked of it. Now, you should know I've taken some creative liberties with this graphic to simplify it for teaching purposes. Processors are much more complex than this, and many of these instructions would actually take more than one clock pulse. The other side of that is many of today's processors can actually perform multiple instructions at the same time. Also, programs mostly go line by line, like what we see here, but they also jump around a lot too, which isn't depicted here. The important thing here is how the clock signal directly affects the speed at which the processor does its tasks. Clocks don't necessarily even need to have a consistent frequency like this one. We could, in theory, stop this clock from oscillating, and the processor would just sit there, waiting for the next pulse, not doing a thing. Today's modern processors are much more complex and probably wouldn't work very well doing that, but for the 6502 chip we're going to be working with, it should work just fine. With some exceptions, a computer's clock runs at a consistent speed. Unless, of course, you have one of these bad boys from back in the day. Pushing the turbo button would speed up the frequency of the clock on the fly, making your computer much faster. If only we still had our turbo buttons today. But clocks don't just exist in computers, they exist in simpler circuits too, like in our previous videos where we built the KCS mixtape, which can decode data off standard audio cassettes. In that circuit, we used a clock signal to tell our shift registers that it was time to shift, and to tell our counters that it was time to count. The clock, or the conductor, in that circuit was our 555 chip, and it was stopped when no data was coming in. Circuits generally don't care what generates the signal. What's important is the signal itself. In fact, there are so many methods to generate clock signals. We could use a 555 timer like we did in the mixtape, or we could use a quartz crystal. Quartz crystals are awesome. When properly cut, tuned, and put into a circuit, they can produce a highly stable, highly accurate signal. Our 6502 computer has a quartz crystal clock in it that operates at 1 megahertz, or 1 million times a second. And crystals can be found in lots of devices, devices such as watches. Quartz crystals in a watch are usually tuned to cycle at 32,768 cycles per second. At first glance, that may seem like a strange number, but 32,768 is actually a power of 2 value, and this makes it really easy to work with digitally. Every time the watch counts to this value, it knows that 1 second has elapsed, signaling the need to update the displayed time, just like we see here. So there are plenty of ways to generate these types of signals. Circuits generally don't care. What's important is the signal itself. So with that in mind, as I was driving around with my family, I was brainstorming ideas for some fun ways to generate some signals like this. And then I came across this beauty in a place called Kewanee, Wisconsin. The world's largest grandfather clock. And this baby was built in 1976 and stands almost 36 feet tall. But more importantly, it has something on it that oscillates, the pendulum. The pendulum on this swings back and forth just like a conductor's wand. So in theory, it should be possible to use this pendulum to generate the signals we need to drive our computer. We just need a way to detect the swing of the pendulum and feed the computer a signal from it. Now, I didn't connect my computer up to this thing, but I totally could have. I did something even more fun. I built my own, and here's my plan. If we take the pendulum of a clock and place some magnets at the very bottom of the pendulum, we can use something called a Hall effect sensor under that to pick up when the pendulum is near the sensor. A Hall effect sensor is kind of like a magnetic switch. It turns on or off depending on whether or not there's a magnetic field nearby. As long as the sensor is sensitive enough and we line things up properly, we should end up with a signal similar to this one, which should look pretty close to the clock signal from before. So I started the design and built the clock face in Fusion 360 exactly as I wanted. I was pretty happy with it and ready to print it, only to find out I made the thing too big for my printer. An amateur mistake. So rather than get mad and spend a lot of time redesigning it, I just chopped off the edges of the circle. So now it looks like this, and I was a little sad at first, but after I saw the results, I actually think it looks kind of cool. So once the design was complete, I printed the parts out on my 3D printer, and each part took a little over 20 hours to print. I then started the assembly. I ran the wires through the holes and up these hollow brass rods for some LEDs. And then I designed this hole here to fit these cute little breadboards I have that also gives us the ability to slide it back and forth to help line up the sensor. Lining it up actually became a bit of an issue, as the sensor wasn't as sensitive as I had hoped. I attempted stronger magnets, but they ended up being attracted too much to the components, causing the pendulum to stop swinging, and sometimes they'd even pull the parts right out of the breadboard. That's not what we wanted. So I went back to the weaker magnets and worked on getting them lined up just right, and the result was a perfect swing, and the sensor was picking it up perfectly. Awesome. With the clock being ready, I wanted to be able to send our computer clock pulses from lots of different types of devices. And since I didn't know what those sources are, I needed to build a circuit that conditions whatever signal we're sending it. So I built this circuit based on a chip called a 74HC123, also known as a Monostable timer. Yep, you can't get away from Mr. Monostable. And this circuit monitors the line coming in from the pendulum, or whatever else we connect up to it, and when it detects a signal, it generates a consistently timed pulse which cleans up the signal nicely and is then passed on to the computer. I then installed an LED to the output so we can see the result of our conditioner visually, and then I connected it to our clock. Check it out. The LED flash coincides with the pendulum swinging over the sensor. If you're thinking the LED is missing some flashes, you'd be wrong. This is only because of the refresh rate on my camera, and I assure you, it's flashing beautifully every time. So with everything built, here's how we're going to connect it all. Here's the pendulum from our clock, and we'll take the output of the Hall effect sensor, and we'll send that over to our monostable conditioner, giving us a nice clean signal. We'll disconnect our computer's real clock and use the output of the monostable to replace it. Now, if we actually want to see something run, we'll need a small program we can run on the 6502. Like, really small. Our computer will be running a million times slower, so for the sake of this video, and our attention spans, I threw together a tiny program that just alternates some LEDs on and off, which can be done with just a handful of instructions. This should be proof enough that it's running as we expect. I compiled it and uploaded it to the 6502 using the KCS mixtape, but let's see what happens if we switch the clock over to using the pendulum. Check it out. The pendulum swings back and forth, causing our monostable to trigger, which causes the LED to flash and then the clock pulse to be sent on to the computer. Every couple clock pulses, the computer moves on to the next instruction, and after 14 or so clock pulses, the LED switch. And after filming this, I actually found some efficiencies to be gained in the code I wrote, and I was actually able to get this down to something like 6 or 8 pulses. Here it is in slow motion. That's so cool. So we proved out that that all works, but what else can we feed into it? We need something that has a repeating pattern. I'd like to find something that maybe nobody has done before. Something important. Something that keeps us alive. How about a human heartbeat? Well, check this out. It's a pretty standard heartbeat. And at an average resting rate, it beats around 60 times per minute or once per second. And if we look at the shape of the beat, its most prominent feature is the peak right here. The peak marks the top of what's called the QRS complex, and it's called this because of the parts of the heartbeat that are broken up like this. So what we want to do is try to detect the R part of the signal, since it should be the easiest. So I first set out to create a circuit from scratch for this, but after doing some research, I realized it was going to take me a long time, and I also started to have some safety concerns. I wasn't really comfortable putting electrodes across my body with a circuit that I designed. But the goal of this project isn't necessarily to design a circuit from scratch, it's to drive a computer using my heart. So after doing some more searching, I found a kit from SparkFun that actually does this already and monitors heart rates. Quick disclaimer here, guys. Please don't try this at home. Don't replicate it. Doing so requires placing electrodes across your body and thus your heart. The voltage levels are low with this, but it's also connected to the mains of your house, so if anything were to go wrong, it could be a very dangerous situation. With that said, here's my plan. The kit comes with 3 electrode sensors that I connect to my body here, here, and here. And it was sometimes a bit of a trial and error, as the kit seemed very sensitive to placement and movement. I also sometimes used another spot here as I was troubleshooting, but the whole setup always felt just a little unpredictable. I connected the electrodes up to the heart monitoring kit, which monitors my heart and has an analog output pin. From there, I connected the heart rate monitor up to an Arduino and wrote a small program that just reads the current value from the monitor. I configured a threshold by watching the values coming in from the sensor, and when the value crossed, say, a threshold of 500, I flashed a blue LED. So now, anytime the blue LED flashes, this should be marking the R stage, or the peak, of my heartbeat. And then that signal was fed into the monostable conditioner that feeds the clock. So let's check this out in action. Here's one of the electrodes, and here it is fed into the heart rate monitor. I do some voltage level changes here that feed into the Arduino. It picks up the heartbeat, flashes the blue LED, which is fed into our monostable conditioner, which then feeds our computer. The computer runs, and the yellow and blue LEDs change, proving that it's all working. Pretty cool. So now, of course, I had to go for a little jog to see if I could speed it up. I also did a bunch of jumping jacks that I didn't film, but here's the result. The heartbeat is faster, though not by much. I guess I'm in surprisingly too good a shape, and the computer's clock is now running a bit faster. I ran into a few issues with this piece, as I think the little bit of sweat I made messed with the sensitivity, and I had to do this a few times and change the threshold value to get somewhat of a stable signal after exercising. But I hope that this helps show that a clock signal is really just oscillating voltage levels. That's pretty cool. Thank you so much for being here and watching, guys. It has been so much fun working on this and sharing them with you and seeing all of your excitement around this. If this is something that you want to see more of, please feel free to like and subscribe. We have so many more ideas coming up that are just going to be crazy and a lot of fun. If you're at all interested in supporting the channel in a more practical way, please feel free to check out my Patreon I've recently set up. I'm just starting to think about what types of perks to include on that, so if you have any ideas, please feel free to let me know. But really, the most practical way you can help right now is really just by sharing this video with someone that you think might enjoy it. It would mean the world to me. I think that's it for now. Thanks so much for being here. I hope you enjoyed learning about clocks and seeing this crazy project. That's all for now, guys. I hope you have a great rest of your day, and bye for now.